it will come back to the triplet state. So for that, we can calculate this, the other quantity. So this is P01. And the summation the other way around. So once it goes to the probability of it to go to this state is, I mean, here it's zero. So we are not going to even count those things because they are forbidden transitions. So it's 2/3 times it goes to one p half state. And from there, 2/9 times it comes back to the triplet state. Plus here, the other way around, that, it goes 1/1 here. And 2/3 times it goes to the 1p3/2. And from there, it comes back 1/9 times. This is the one corresponding transition. So we have here 2/ go on. So this is also the same thing. Anyways, so I'll figure out where's the mistake. So this is 4/27 and we were correct about that. This is the 4/27 this is 4/9. Where did I make the mistake? Can anyone tell me? Oh yes. When this person is this atom is making transition, we don't need to count that it makes how many total number of transition that it makes this thing. We need to count what fraction of transitions from here are to the triplet state. So instead of 2/9, it's going to be 2/3 because this is 2+1. So this makes, once this state de-excites, 2/3 of the time it de-excites to the triplet state and 1/3 of the time it de-excites to the singlet state. So this is 3 and not 9, and this is again 3. So this is 9 and this is 9 and this is 4/9. So that's the correct number, and this was first calculated calculated in this context by Field, and most of the spin temperature on 21, I mean the Lyman alpha physics that we use in Cosmic Dawn has been derived by Field. So we have these numbers finally that comes from the atomic physics. And now this quantity, which basically I had not defined earlier, it is the rate of scattering of Lyman alpha photons. So this is basically that if in a medium you know the number density of Lyman alpha photons, and you know the cross section of Lyman alpha photons, which we had already given in the previous tutorial, then, and this is the velocity of the Lyman, basically that velocity. So this is the rate of scattering of Lyman alpha photons in a medium with this number density. And it turns out to be this. So this is the scattering rate. And this is the coupling coefficient. So finally, this is, do you remember that spin temperature equation? So this was the spin temperature equation that you have. So basically this is T gamma, which you can take to be CMB temperature. Then y alpha t alpha plus yk tk tc, sorry. So this was the spin temperature equation, and that is the coupling coefficient here. So basically what happens is that irrespective of what is the value of CMB temperature or Lyman alpha temperature, if this factor is very, very large, say for example, then you can actually neglect this term and this term if this temperature is, this coupling coefficient is very, very large. And so essentially your spin temperature becomes equivalent to the color temperature of the Lyman alpha line, which we have put equivalent to the kinetic temperature also. So basically this is the coupling coefficient, which determines the strength of coupling of spin temperature to the kinetic temperature, or basically Lyman alpha temperature. Is this fine so far? Any questions? Okay. Please ask questions, because later on in the after this topic is done, I'm going to ask you people to provide answers, because I want you people to tell me what is going to happen. So after this topic is done, this is the final derivation. After this, you have to give me answers. Okay. So this is the coupling coefficient that we have used, and this is its definition. This is how it was defined using that detailed balance which you derived yesterday. So this is the coupling coefficient, and writing in terms of this, we can write this as, write this factor, which is the probability of, I mean, it's basically rate of transition. This is the rate of transition from triplet to singlet using Lyman alpha at color temperature. So this is defined at color temperature of T alpha, and the rest of these two are the constants for your 21 centimeter line. So this is written as this. We simply replaced this value from here, and then finally we put in the value of the cross section here. So this is the expression that we have for the coupling coefficient. Now, if you see, this is the only factor in which any astrophysics goes in, that the temperature of the Lyman alpha might be determined by your source of Lyman alpha, and the resonance width might be determined by your temperature, etc. And the number density of Lyman alpha will also be determined by the source, etc. Rest of the other things are all just constants. So, and this was the expression derived in Field's paper, but I just have one factor off from it, which I think I have used. I mean, so if you use exactly what I have, what value of resonance width I have taken, this is the expression you will get. But he probably uses some different expression, or probably something I missed, I don't know. But this is, apart from this square root factor, it's the same expression. So basically what this tells us is that this coupling coefficient is a function of, apart from all these constants, is a function of these two things, basically the number density of Lyman alpha and the temperature. And what it says is that for larger number density of Lyman alpha photons, basically if there are large number density of Lyman alpha photons, then the coupling of spin temperature to kinetic temperature is much more stronger, which is what we understand, right? If there is larger number of Lyman alpha photons, their effect is going to be stronger. So this is the number density, it's proportional to number density. And there is this factor that it decreases with kinetic temperature, and this factor came from two places. One, which came from this, so there was this TK factor, and another factor came, half TK factor, from the resonance width. So this is proportional to 3/2. So basically, which means that for colder regions, the coupling is much stronger than it is for the warmer regions. So this is the coupling coefficient. If you have any questions, you can ask. Okay, so finally we have this coupling, and this was the spin temperature equation which I had written previously. Now, this is the kind of geometry. This is a very rough cartoon. This is not to scale, because all these processes are orders of magnitude different apart, which we derived earlier. But basically on a cartoon scale, what this is that this is the Lyman alpha coupling region. This is the X-ray heating region, and this is the ionized region, H2 region, okay. And within this ionized region, this is the Stromergren sphere which we had derived. So this is the cosmology equivalent of that Stromergren sphere. This is the ionization bubble. And there will be multiple sources within that same bubble. And so this is basically the ionized region. All the sources are located within it. Now, can someone tell me if, I mean, so this temperature within this region is going to be TK equals 10 to power 4 Kelvin. Can we define spin temperature here? I would like someone to answer. Please, let's talk. Now, this is, let's just make this informal discussion. Let's talk. I want everyone to talk, like, whatever you think.
You may call them by name. Yeah.
I actually can't see the chat screen while writing on here. So probably I should open the list of participants and keep that aside. Okay. So anyone?
Please. Please participate in the discussion.
Okay, so first tell me, is there, this is the region in which there is, we have assuming that the all the hydrogen that is within this region, apart from your small clumps, which a clumping factor which I talked about, everything else is ionized. So apart from the small clumps, rest of the medium which is ionized cannot emit 21 centimeter radiation, because this 21 centimeter radiation comes from the neutral hydrogen. So within this ionized region, you cannot even, you do not have any 21 centimeter signal. So what 21 centimeter signal I mean is this differential brightness temperature. And so this is basically proportional to TCMB by TS. Times the neutral fraction, right? So here everything is, say for example, ionized, then here, within this region, the differential brightness temperature is zero. Anyone disagrees? Anyone has any doubt? Okay, so this is your first region. This is the ionized region. Then what happens within X-ray heated region? Anyone? What is the temperature? Say, for, is this temperature X-ray heating, because of X-ray heating? Is, say, for example, this is my background temperature. What is the temperature here? Is this going to be, how will it compare to the background temperature? There is X-ray heating here, right? Someone please talk, at least answer wrong things. It's okay, just answer, please. Okay, so this is the, someone raised hand, it seems. You can just unmute and talk. Hi, Aman?
Yes, ma'am. Now you can ask something.
No, your hand is raised. You have a question?
Yes, ma'am. You were asking about this temperature difference.
Yes.
I am seeing echo. I am hearing echo.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't know.
Now it's fine, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah.
So this temperature inside the X-ray heating would be higher than the background temperature. Yeah.
Okay. So let's call this X-ray heated temperature, and it will be larger. So obviously you will have profiles that there will be larger temperature here, then it will fall. I mean, the temperature will decrease as you go farther away from the source. But in general, you expect this to be larger than the background temperature. Okay. Now, let's say this is where the effect of most of the X-ray heating is. Okay. So here the kinetic temperature is going to be equal to background temperature. Is that fine?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is your kinetic temperature so far. Okay. Here within this, the kinetic temperature was very large. This is here, the kinetic temperature is slightly larger than background temperature, a little larger than background temperature in this region. It's because it is outside your X-ray heating, it's background. It's the same as background temperature. Okay. Now this is one thing. Now let's talk about coupling. So within
coupling is Lyman alpha coupling is nearly equals to zero, right? For inside part.
Inside here.
Yes.
Yeah, because
and it will increase according
to
this.
Here you can say y alpha equals zero. Fine. In this region, it will be coupled. Sorry, this should be wrong. Here there will be coupling, right?
Yeah, it will decrease to the t to the power minus 3 by 2, right? Yeah.
Okay, you have derived it?
No, you derived it.
Okay. No, so yeah, so there will be multiple effects. That first thing is, yes, it's going to decrease. And so basically, let's say here till this point, the Lyman alpha is larger than 1. Which means that there is enough coupling. Okay, there is enough coupling. Now, so there is this. This is for all of this region. So we took care of the kinetic temperature. We took care of this is equal to Tk. We took care of Lyman alpha. Now let's say this one. This one was proportional to. Basically, if you remember, this was proportional to the rate coefficients, or basically of hydrogen, and their number density. But we actually can derive, and I will talk about. I mean, this I think other people might have talked, but if they have not, then I should have done. Basically, by the redshift of cosmic dawn. These number densities are so small that they are not able to couple this efficiently. So why coupling coefficient is less than 1 by the epoch of cosmic dawn? Apart from one thing, that there is a small caveat, which is key. Surrounding the sources, the temperature is rising, and this coupling coefficient rises with temperature. And also surrounding the sources, the number density is expected to be higher. So you can say that till very nearby the sources, there might be a small shell in which there might be coupling coefficient, collisional coupling coefficient is large, but not very far. So most of the coupling is taken care of by Lyman alpha. Is that fine?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Okay, go on.
Nothing, thank you. Yeah,
so this is basically you have. So now we took care of this coupling coefficient. Now what is left? CMB temperature is common for all of them, so we can simply calculate the brightness temperature, and let's do that. So brightness temperature within inside this region, we already know that it's going to be zero, because the ionization, I mean the neutral fraction within that region is zero. So here the brightness temperature within this region is zero. Now the brightness temperature in this region, what is it, how is it going to be? Is it going to be zero, or will it be different?
Yeah, it is positive.
Yes. So let's just say for example, this temperature is larger than CMB temperature. Just let's guess it, that this X-ray temperature is larger than CMB temperature. Then this brightness temperature delta. Hi. Is going to be greater than zero, because this region is neutral, and the spin temperature is, and this kinetic temperature is coupled to the spin temperature because there is coupling. Oh, no, not this one. So there is coupling. Yeah, so because of this coupling, you have spin temperature equivalent to this. And therefore, the brightness temperature is going to be larger in this region, larger than, it's positive. Now, what about this larger region? There is no X-ray heating here. And let's say this background temperature is less than CMB.
Okay, cool. Cool.
The sound is not clear.
Yeah, Rupa, there is a lot of disturbance on your side.
Yeah, can you just write the question in the chat box?
Welcome, hello. Am I anyone?
No, it's not. It is better if you write it in the chat box.
Yeah, I'm sorry. This is a very crowded diagram. I should have probably written more carefully. But I can rub everything and write again. So, Rupa, are you going to type the answer? Does anyone else want to attempt it till then? What is going to be, what is your spin temperature here? What is the spin temperature in this region? We are saying that there is sufficient coupling. What happens then? What happens to spin temperature?
Janki, there was one reply from Rupa. So she's telling, I think brightness temperature should be negative.
Yes, that's correct. So this brightness temperature is negative. Why is that? The spin temperature is coupled to the kinetic temperature, okay, which we put assume that it was background temperature, which is less than CMB temperature. So your differential brightness temperature is negative. So basically what happens in the initial stages of cosmic dawn is, within the ionized region, there is no signal. There is no 21 centimeter signal within the ionized region. Then within X-ray heated region, there's going to be signal in emission. And on a larger region, which is coupled by Lyman alpha, but not heated, the brightness temperature is going to be negative. And farther away from that, because here the coupling is equal to zero, your delta TB, brightness temperature, will also be zero. So this is the kind of geometry which you expect during the early stages of cosmic dawn. Now what happens with the expansion is that basically these Lyman alpha regions, they are much larger. So Lyman alpha regions of multiple sources will start growing and expanding, and they will start merging with each other. And at a certain redshift, almost all the universe is coupled through Lyman alpha. So the Lyman alpha coupling has saturated. So that's one saturation. Let's call that Lyman alpha saturation. And this means that the spin temperature is equal to kinetic temperature. So that's one kind of saturation. After that, what happens is there's this heated regions. They will also start growing and expanding. So basically, within certain regions, your kinetic temperature eventually will become much, much larger than CMB temperature. And because this is equal to the spin temperature, your spin temperature becomes much larger than CMB temperature. So this whole term drops out from your equation. And so what that means is that brightness temperature becomes independent of the kinetic temperature and spin temperature. So that is called saturated heating. So that is another saturation. So that is heating saturation. So, and that is when this kinetic temperature is much, much greater than CMB temperature. So while this kinetic temperature is less than CMB temperature, you'll have signal in absorption. When the kinetic temperature is larger than CMB temperature, you'll have signal in emission. And once the saturation has taken place, your brightness temperature is going to be independent of kinetic temperature. Okay. So this two terms people often use. Now, anyone has any doubt here? I'm sure this is very crowded and I can do a better job probably. But
most of all, it's good. I'll just carry on.
Okay. Finally, so this is the evolution of spin temperature here. And basically what this plot was already shown by Ashiel, and this is for the standard cosmology that we have. So this is the CMB temperature, which is falling constantly always as CMB which is always falling as 1 by Z. Then the meta temperature, the kinetic temperature. So for some times it falls along with CMB, such where the kinetic temperature is CMB temperature. But the gas temperature up below certain redshift, which we call the thermal decoupling redshift, it starts falling. It starts falling as 1 by 1 plus Z square. Right. So this is the adiabatic cooling region. And now, because spin temperature is a linear combination of these two temperatures, the spin CMB temperature and the kinetic temperature, it always remains between these two. So this, when the spin kinetic temperature is less than CMB temperature, the spin temperature is larger than kinetic temperature but less than CMB temperature. And when the kinetic temperature is larger, it's the other way around. So this is unless there is some other coupling mechanism. Unless, say, for example, there was some exotic coupling mechanism which coupled the spin temperature to brightness temperature. In that case, it might go towards a third new temperature, which we have not taken into account in this case. So this is for the standard standard model. Now, okay, so what is happening? Let's see what is happening in this thing. Can someone tell me first why this spin temperature is falling first? Why is the spin temperature not equal to the CMB temperature?
It is coupled with temperature, gas temperature, kinetic temperature. That's why, and which falls differently from CMB.
Yes. So we have that here, this basically spin temperature in this region, spin temperature is coupled to the kinetic temperature because the collisional coupling coefficient is large. Okay. So what happens here? Why does this go down? Why does it not follow gas temperature anymore in this place? Okay, so this collisional coupling coefficient, do you remember this collisional I already talked about in previous slides. The collisional coupling coefficient was proportional to number density of electrons or number density of hydrogen, right? So what is happening to that number density now with the expanding universe?
It's decreasing.
Yes, so this coupling coefficient now becomes inefficient. So it's less than 1 and you do not have, the coupling is basically decreasing. So this spin temperature now starts approaching the CMB temperature. Fine. Then again, at certain redshift, say this is where the cosmic dawn starts, the new star sources have started forming. And it again starts in decreasing the spin temperature. Why is that? What new is happening here? This coupling coefficient, the collisional coupling coefficient remains less, it cannot become larger. It can become larger, but it will not be sufficiently large. So
is it because sources are ionizing hydrogen?
That will happen later. So ionization will happen even below redshift 10. So but apart from ionizing radiation, they are also emitting Lyman alpha, right? So now the Lyman alpha coupling becomes larger, right? So this at this, all these epochs, there were no sources of Lyman alpha because there was no recombination, there were no sources of ionization. The only coupling which was taking place was because the hydrogen atoms were colliding with each other and they were colliding with electrons. So because of that collision, there were spin flip transitions happening and the spin temperature was getting coupled to the kinetic temperature. But those collisions have declined by this redshift. But there is a new source of coupling now, which is because the sources have started forming, there is Lyman alpha. So the Lyman alpha is now coupling spin temperature. So now again, the spin temperature goes towards the kinetic temperature. And finally, at this place, there's something else happening. The kinetic temperature itself is rising. Why is that?
Heating.
Yes. So this is because of extra heating. So now the this is called, and by the way, this is called the redshift of heating transition. So this is heating transition when the kinetic temperature goes from, I mean, this is when the kinetic temperature is same as CMB temperature, just for a certain redshift. After that, it becomes larger. And your spin temperature is now again larger. And it remains, after this, it closely almost follows the kinetic temperature because this factor remains large now for the rest of the history. Fine. So this is your standard, this is a basic cartoon, basically. All this redshift where the sources start forming, where the heating transition takes place, where this turn off takes from cooling to heating, etc. All those things will depend on your astrophysics. So for that, we need a lot more careful modeling. But this is the kind of shape that we expect in general. Fine. Okay. And so this is the 21 centimeter signal that people have been trying to detect. And we can try to see all those same things which took place here, effects here. So this is where finally thermal decoupling took place. This is the place where the coupling coefficient are becoming small. So this is becoming, the spin temperature is going equal to CMB temperature. So the differential brightness temperature is zero. So I should probably put that spin temperature equation everywhere. Two equations, that spin temperature is equal to CMB temperature plus,
sorry. There was one question from Ardhudeep. So yes. He's asking, how does the spin temperature evolve below Z of the order of 10 or when then reionization starts? So,
So after this, what you expect is the spin temperature, basically is the spin temperature, the way you define spin temperature is going to keep on rising. Okay, it will rise till around 10 to power 4 and even a little more because the kinetic temperature will go to that, that scale. But so the basically spin temperature will keep on rising. Spin temperature, it will always now follow the kinetic temperature. But the problem starts because now the neutral fraction itself is dropping. So let me write down that both the equations and then we'll see what this brightness temperature.
So just to mention, we'll discuss in details all of this, but this picture you should keep in mind. So this is a standard picture, and this the redshift may change model to model.
Yes.
This is the standard picture you should keep in mind, and Tirth will discuss all the physics and all these things in details here in the following week.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. So basically what we have is, when the reionization starts, basically neutral fraction is dropping. That's why your 21 centimeter differential brightness temperature, basically this signal drops, but the spin temperature itself will keep on rising. But once the universe becomes ionized, you can no longer even define spin temperature because there is no neutral hydrogen. Is that fine? Okay. So finally, what we have is that now the heating, this is where the first stars and galaxies are forming. And here now finally Lyman alpha coupling starts, and here the X-ray heating starts, and this is where the reionization starts. So as Rajesh said, this Tirth will discuss this part in way more detail, and mostly this is a very old plot. What recent observation suggests is that the redshift of reionization is close to 6 or even less than 6. This is an old plot. It's like 2010 plot, a decade year old plot. So This shows the redshift of reionization to be around 7.5 or so. But anyways, let's just focus on what happens to the signal in this window, which is the cosmic dawn window, that before the reionization starts sufficiently and after this, basically first sources are formed. Okay. So now people have done a lot of very detailed modelings for this this things, and you can take, say, for example, what is the heating efficiency, what is the spectrum of heating, what is the minimum mass of the sources that can form, and what sort of sources will there be, what is the ionization efficiency, what is the fraction of all these photons which can escape from the source halo, what is the etc. There's a lot of modeling parameters which you can use. And using those things, basically, people have, this is from Anastasia, and they have, there is a large number of models which are this 21 centimeter signal possibles, which we do not have very many constraints on these models currently. The only thing which we had is what Edges discussed, Edges, which you discussed today. But basically, let's just, Shiv has already shown one version of this plot previously. So I will, in brief, somebody had questions. So let's just see what is the effect of two things which I talked about. One is Lyman alpha, and then there is going to be an X-ray heating. Okay. So what is its effect?
Janki, there is one question from Rupa. So yeah? She's asking, in the dark ages, does the Lyman alpha effect have any effects on skin temperature?
Okay, so the problem is during dark ages, during this ages, there is no source of Lyman alpha. The thing is, because for the sources of Lyman alpha is created through recombinations mostly, or they might be created in the black body spectra of the stars. So those are the two, sources, main sources of Lyman alpha during cosmic dawn. During dark ages, the only source of Lyman alpha which you can take into, which you know for sure exists, is the CMB. So CMB in its basically very large frequency limit, there is Lyman alpha there, but you can calculate its number density and it's very small. So you can calculate the coupling coefficient corresponding to CMB during dark ages, and it's very small, so it's almost negligible. You can calculate that for yourself using this previous. Does that answer question?
Okay.
So these are the possible models, and now the only thing I want to mention here is basically mostly this was discussed in detail by Shiv today, and people even had questions, so we can discuss those. Basically, the dotted lines are where there is a parameter which I have defined, which was called N heat. It is equal to 0.1. The dashed line is where N heat is equal to 1, and the solid lines are when N heat equals 10. So these are a factor of 10 different. What is basically happening is, if let's just first focus on just heating. So look at the same color plot, but different line style. So say, for example, this green plot. The only difference is heating. So at large redshift, basically, this is the large redshift. At large redshift, it looks almost the same, but it becomes different at smaller redshift. And what is changing is that it's when it starts going, what is the minimum signal that it can have in absorption depends on the heating. When it starts going from emission to absorption, basically the redshift of heating transition, that depends on the heating, and the maximum signal that it can have in emission, that also depends on heating, right? So these are the things which you can see, that these three look very similar here, but they look very different in this era. So heating plays a very important role here. Now, the second effect which we want to do is the Lyman alpha. So for Lyman alpha, let's look at, for example, three solid lines. These are the solid lines. And what we can see is that once the heating starts, like basically even when the Lyman alpha, so basically this Shiv has already talked about this. What Lyman alpha does, that it couples the spin temperature to the kinetic temperature. So if you do not have heating and if the Lyman alpha starts coupling, in that case it will couple to cold gas and you'll get a very deep signal. If there is no Lyman alpha, then there will be no signal. So only when Lyman alpha starts coupling, then with this you will see some signal, right? So there will be no signal till there is Lyman alpha coupling. So for the same amount of heating, until Lyman alpha coupling saturates, they will look very different, and Lyman alpha and after that they will look similar. So this is the Lyman alpha, and this you can say probably at certain point the Lyman alpha coupling is saturating. What another thing, so basically what determines when this signal goes down is determined by Lyman alpha, and when it will come up, it is determined by X-rays, and the minimum signal depth is determined by combination of both these effects. And so people have used these things, basically these kind of models, to get astrophysics out of even edges signal, which is without trying to explain why it is so deep. So this is basically the edges signal. And what you can see is that it limits a certain redshift when the Lyman alpha starts coupling. It also restricts a certain redshift when it starts heating. And you can basically, of course, this shape is wrong, but you can also tell when your minimum what redshift it takes place. So if you ignore, for example, the strength of the signal, then you can get a lot of astrophysics out of the information about your sources out of this edge signal, and people have done that. Okay, now I was going to show a little basically to explain edges, people have taken a lot of different models and one toy model. This is not feasible, which you talked about, was that we tried changing the residual ionization fraction and to see what effect it has on the spin temperature, and then eventually the your 21 centimeter signal. So you can see that if you change this, if your residual ionization fraction was less by two orders of magnitude, you can get a very different shape of the signal compared to this. So this is for this your standard signal for a certain set of parameters of heating and ionization, heating and coupling. For the same parameters, your signal with the different residual ionization will look very different. And you can see its effect also on the power spectrum, that the power spectrum looks is going to be about like 1 to 2 orders of magnitude larger if you have if you had this different residual ionization. And this was the basically edges signal which we had plotted. Now, I think Shiv has already discussed this in detail, so I don't want to go into complete detail about this, and I'm also running out of time. So finally, only I will show is this, that this was the power spectrum. And this, the power spectrum corresponds to the same thing, that there is a different amount of heating, there is different amount of coupling, and you can see that the power spectrum, the maximum power spectrum that you can get also is determined by both the X-ray heating and Lyman alpha coupling. And this is for edges, and it is about like 1 to 2 orders of magnitude larger. Now, I don't think I can go in more details, but if somebody has questions, let's ask and let's discuss. I think I just have 5 minutes, so let's just discuss now.
So in case you have too many questions, then people can also continue the discussion in the Slack channel. But if you have some immediate short questions, then you can just ask.
Yeah.
Hello. Can you explain the Lyman alpha saturation?
Okay. So, okay, let's look at this equation. And what is happening here is that this skin temperature is a linear combination of all these different temperatures, because this is how we have defined that this, I mean, this is not a real temperature, but we have defined it as a combination of all these different temperatures. Saturation means that this at all places in the universe, that after a certain redshift, at all places in the universe, even very far away from many sources, this coupling coefficient is very large, which means that a large number of Lyman alpha photons from the sources have penetrated even far away from the sources and coupled the spin temperature to the kinetic temperature. I mean, this is going to be equal to kinetic temperature. So the saturation means that at all places, everywhere, spin temperature is equal to kinetic temperature. Once you can take this assumption, because of Lyman alpha during cosmic dawn, then that is Lyman alpha saturation. Is that fine?
Thank you. Okay.
There is one question from Arghadeep Basu. So, yeah. Just hold on, I'll just try to unmute you. Yeah. Arghadeep, you can ask.
Yeah, please ask.
Oh, his microphone is not working. So, okay, I will just pass the question to you. That the question is regarding the plot of temperature with redshift, tuning the SL values. So with the subject, so question is, what I feel dotted line trace the edges result better than others. So can we tune N heat even lower values than 0.1, say 0.01, 0.001, so on. Other factors make it shifted to higher Z values.
Okay, so you are saying this one, this dotted line matches the best with edges. Is that the... Did I understand this question correct?
Yes, maybe. Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, so the heating parameter is actually not very well understood, not very well modeled also. And why is that? Is because there are two things which we don't know. I mean, it can be very small, but why? What we don't know is basically sources. So there are two type of sources of X-rays. One is going to be X-rays emitted from, basically... disks around high mass X-ray binaries, and then there will be because of stellar sources. So X-rays which are what sources we have at higher redshift, we do not know, because the population 3 stars will have different evolution than the stars which we have in local universe. So that's one thing which we do not know, sources. Second thing which we do not know is what is the escape fraction. So there might be within the sources, basically within a galaxy, what fraction of your photons are able to escape from that galaxy, what fraction is absorbed or scattered by molecules, etc., within the galaxy. That is again something which we need to model very carefully, and it has a lot of uncertainties. So that is also we do not know. So that is the escape fraction. The similar thing is a scenario with also, the ionizing photons, etc. So basically, we don't know what is the value of this. And people have, that's why, modeled all sorts of things. It's possible it can be very small. Heating is very small. But then if the heating is very small, you will not be able to, you will need to account for other things, basically. Also, edges is not this large. Edges is something like this. It's very sharp, and which means that the heating starts very fast, very soon. We don't know why.
Okay, so he's satisfied. Okay, thanks.
So many of the missions are going on. So do only we have one signal of edges, or like we have other signals? And when are we expecting to get other signals?
So people are trying since many years. The problem is, basically the signal is of Millikelvin order. and everything else which is emitting in this, people will talk to you about, people will talk about this. You'll have this observation as the next sessions in next week. But the main problem is that it's very, very difficult to find this signal. And even if we observe something, it's very difficult to confirm that this is the signal and not some artifact. So efforts are ongoing. There are even this kind of experiments in India. But let's see when they...
Yeah, can I just comment one thing? I think there was one workshop, about a month back. So there was a session devoted explicitly on this foreground issue, which is the major obstacle towards detecting all those signals. So it's basically finding needle in the haystacks. So I think Janki has just touched on it. So if you want more discussion on it, you can just refer to our workshop videos, but you can get more extensive discussion on this.
Yes, it's there. It's available on EOR Cosmology 20 site. I actually had.
So please have a look at it if time permits, and then come back to us or any one of us.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Thank you for your suggestion.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions?
It seems like. Looks like there are none. So.
Okay.
So, Radesh, can you?
Yeah, thanks everyone. Okay, one last comment. I have sent a tutorial sheet. You don't actually have to submit answer or anything, but please try to solve them using the notes. If you are going to, basically working in this field, Cosmic Dawn, you'll need to be able to derive those quantities, etc. So take a look at it and see if you can solve. If you cannot, then I'll send answer sheets in a couple of days. So try over the weekend if you can.
Yeah, and that, and these things will be very useful for your next week classes, because this is the groundwork needed for this is the background needed for the EOR physics. So if you don't understand the cosmic dawn well, then you will not be very useful the EOR classes. So please pay attention to the questions. Yeah.
So thanks a lot, everyone. And it was nice teaching. Thank you.
Yeah.